Hi, I'm Rosemary Rivoli, and I am here at Cheesequake State Park with Jim Garcia from the Nerds. Jim,
yes.
Welcome.
Woo!
Thanks for being here with us.
Glad to be here. Going to have a lot of fun.
Looking forward to it. So tonight is our grand finale of the summer concerts series in the park for the Township of Old Bridge Cultural Arts Committee. And our closer is the Nerds tonight. And everyone is very excited. We have a great turnout here. The weather is perfect. Couldn't ask for more. But let's find out a little bit about the Nerds. So I know that you span a very long generation. I have to admit, I was in high school. Coming and hanging out with you.
Several generations, yes. In fact, we've played weddings of a child whose parents met at one of our earlier shows. So we've done that twice, and it's kind of interesting.
That I would say so.
The best thing is we have a lot of people come up to us at shows and say, my mother, and that's the beginning of a terrible sentence, was such a big fan of you guys for so many years. And like... Yeah, well, good. We've been around 33 years. I'll take it.
That's good. Well, tell us how it started. So did you start playing in the school band? Were you singing first? What were you doing?
Well, no, we've all been playing all of our lives. As far as this band, we everybody had individually been in other bands for about 10, 12, 15 years. And then this kind of came together at the behest of our manager, who said, why don't you put a band together, call yourselves the Nerds, dress like this? And we said, sure, sounds stupid enough. Let's do it for 6 months and, you know, have some fun. And that turned into a year, 5 years, 10 years, 33 years.
Love it. That's fantastic. It's very exciting. And I know that your son now plays also. He was telling me I met him earlier today.
Yes. Yeah, he's the drummer in a band called Jack the Band. And they're very good. They're very good. I'm proud of the work that he's doing with those guys. Yeah.
That's fabulous. That's fantastic.
We'll see them soon enough all over the place.
Good. Looking forward to it. So tell us, I want to know, what is your favorite, all-time favorite song to play?
I guess it would have to be Bohemian Rhapsody, because everybody loves when we play it, and it's it's a little bit of a challenge, a departure. I can't sing it as good as I used to, but who can?
This is true. It's a hard one. And then what is your least favorite, but we won't tell anyone?
Oh, Blurred Lines. I can't stand that song. Every time I play it, I want to rip my head off.
Please don't. Please don't, because who will entertain us?
That's and right. This guy.
This guy. Who is this guy?
This is Mongo. He doesn't speak.
You don't speak?
No. He was brushing his teeth. Somebody switched the crazy glue with the toothpaste, and now we got this.
I love it. Oh, now, that brings up something. Tell me how you all got your name. I know how he got his. You just told us. How'd you get yours?
Spaz? Well, if you saw me comport myself at any given...
See? That's how he got it.
I thought you don't talk.
I bump into things, and quite frequently, and move a little faster than the typical person. But
cool. And then how about the other guys in the band?
There's Biff on the drums. He's just the Biff. And Stretch is quite tall.
Quite tall. Okay. Very good. Well, we're looking forward to having you perform for us. So thank you again for coming to Old Bridge. Just before you go, I just want to mention you were also an Old Bridge resident for
For 7 years at Whispering Pines off of 516. That's right.
Yes, that's right. So very good. Well, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Pleasure to have you. We're here with the man who needs no introduction, our mayor, Mayor Owen Henry. Hello, Mayor.
Good evening.
So I want to talk to you about the cultural arts. We revised this now and brought back, we revitalized, I should say, and brought back the concerts in the park series. And a lot of it is really due to you because you've been instrumental in really supporting and pushing the arts in town. So, you know, why don't you share what your visions are going forward?
Well, like any town, you know, Old Bridge, I think arts are very important. I think it brings a lot to the community. Anyone who can express themselves and make people feel happy, we have to provide that opportunity. And I'm so thankful for you and the cultural arts community for what you've done. Like you said, it kind of slipped away for a few years there. I don't know why. I've always been a big supporter of the arts, but I think you're the difference. We've got somebody who... we have the same, we think alike. You're a very creative person. You like... creative people get attracted to you for some reason. I don't know why, but we have some characters here joining us tonight. It's great. I really do enjoy music, painting, whatever, you know, anybody, you know, it's not just all about, you know, sports. Arts are very important in our culture as, and I think it's important for any town to support the people who want to be creative.
Thank
and
you.
Enjoy music.
That's right. Yeah. There's
music
a lot
been
to be
around a long time.
That's right. So here with us tonight, we have the Old Bridge Militia, which is a really important foundation, I should say, out here in the town. Do you want to talk a little bit about that? Because you've been here with their family.
Yeah, I've been here a long time with the militia. They they're a unique organization. I don't know of any other one. They've helped, you know, bands and individual artists who were starting off and couldn't afford a hotel room. We all know the story about Metallica. But that's just, you know, just one thing. And they're helping people as we speak today. I saw on Facebook the other day a young pianist, I believe, is getting lessons and some, you know, help with that. So I think that's important when you have a group in town that actually supports young, inspiring musicians. And hopefully they'll come back to the community like Obuchi Militia has. And they do fundraising for just about every organization you can think of in town. I'm a big supporter of the Obuchi Militia. Again, I grew up with them in town. And it was always about, you know, helping other people through music.
Right, they're very important. And we're glad that they're here with us tonight, and we'll be meeting with them shortly also. So, but I just want to say thank you so much, because you really, like I said, have been very instrumental in bringing the arts back, bringing the summer concert series. And even though today is the closing finale of our program, we're already set up and lines up and scheduled for next year. We're kicking off.
Same thing. You know, this is the last show of this year, but I'm so excited about next year because of all the things we've talked about. And, you know, I can't wait to start putting a schedule together for next year.
Yep. Well, we'll see you then. So thank you so much, Mayor. It's always a pleasure. So I'm here with Metal Joe Chimente and Ray Dill. They're from the Old Bridge Militia Foundation, which is a fabulous foundation that the mayor just told us about. So let's ask them a little bit about it. So Joe, tell us how exactly the foundation started.
Well, what came out of like a crazy story of our lives back in 83 with Metallica and Slayer and all them type of bands from Johnny Z's record store. He wanted to start a label, and he needed a lot of help, and we were a couple guys from Old Bridge that had houses that we could put the bands up. So the whole story comes out of that 83, 84 era when we had these bands that used to live with us, and now 2014, we decided to bring it back as the Old Bridge Militia Foundation to help out kids and take that story from what it was and turn it into a total positive with helping out kids that can't afford musical instruments and lessons. So we were able to get a 501c3 charity listing with the help of Andy Ellis, who's an Old Bridge guy, who's a big lawyer in California that gave us all the money and the lawyer to get that. And then Metallica helped us with the letters. They let us use their signature M&A barbed letters to incorporate into the logo. And it's a miracle, the whole thing that came out of it. And now we have over 20 students at a couple different Old Bridge Music and a couple other places that we have our kids at. So that's really basically the background of it. So we just want to try to build it bigger and bigger and try to be able to get more kids into the program. But it's also all about, you know, money.
Is there any story that resonates with either one of you of giving a lesson or an instrument to a certain child that was like over the moon, that just like really sticks out in your head, that was like, oh, this is why we do this?
Well, we just, Ray's neighbor donated a piano, and we've never done that. We always buy keyboards. So we got a couple great guys that help us out, you know. So that was a pretty amazing thing, getting that piano out of a guy's basement, getting it into our trailer and bring it over to this kid who's got autism and he lives with his grandmother and mother over in Jackson, and delivering a piano. I thought that was a pretty big deal. Ray's probably got some.
We talked to the mother maybe the next day, and she said the kid never got off the thing. So that's our main focus here, is once we get the instruments and the lessons to the kids, is that they practice. You know, we don't want them coming back to the lesson the following week and they got nothing done, because then there's really nothing coming out of it. We want to try to steer them away from their computers and their phones and stuff and tape music and go to acoustic music, where you have to actually play an instrument and learn how to play one. So anything we could do to keep the kids out of trouble, especially what's going on in the world today, what the kids are getting into. And we're trying the best we can.
We're making a difference, and that's all we're really trying to do, is make a difference and give the gift of music to children who can't afford it.
Well, you guys are doing a fabulous job, and you know what? I have to tell you, as a member of the community, I'm so grateful and thankful that we have organizations like this. And the truth is, we're going to help you and get the word out there. Thank you for coming. Thank you for all the great work that you do.
everybody, we're the Nerds. much better. I'm funky now in every way. But I'll never lose that feeling. No, I won't. Oh, how I learned my lesson that day. Where it was dancing and singing. Whoa!
So, here's what we're going to do now. We're going to do a sing-along. All you people sitting on the hill have to sing along with us. It's simple. Sweet Caroline, and then you go, ba, ba, ba. Can begin to know it, but then I know it's going strong. Stretch, do you remember the TV commercial for Coca-Cola with everybody on the hill singing along?
Yeah, what song was that?
I'd like to teach the world to sing.
I'd like to teach, that's right, I'd like to teach the world to sing.
Yeah.
I'd like to build the world a home and furnish it with love.
Boy, you just brought back some memories,
right? Terrible ones, right?
Where it began, I can't begin to know it, but then I know it's going strong.
We'll take this over now.
Was in the spring, and spring became the summer. Could I believe you'd come along?
Put your hands up in the air, let's go!
Such a hand, reaching out, touching me, touching you. Sweet Caroline.
Sing it!
Good times never stop.
that was beautiful.
It was.
It was nice.
And they sang nicely.
It was like a commercial.
That's what it is.
It was like a commercial.
It was. It was. The Coca-Cola people are crying right now because of how amazing that was. Thanks for singing along. Right now, we're going to do a nice quiet song. These ladies have been dancing. We want to see other of the gentlemen who, you know, have 17 excuses why they don't want to dance. Not one of them legit. I don't care about your knees or your feet or what you did this morning. You should get up and dance on this one. So guys, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3. Summer wind came blowing in from across the sea. It lingered there to touch your hand and walk with me. All summer long we sang a song and we strolled that golden sand. We'll be right back.
do we go? Oh, where do we go now?
Myself. So pretty, too high, I can't. girls hitch, hallelujah. Girls hitch, hallelujah. Girls hitch, hallelujah. Cause Uptown Funk on here, it's here. Uptown Funk on here, it's here.
Don't tell me what you want.
Well, I for seven, eight years, I lived at Whispering Pines off of 516. Does anybody
have fans?
Anybody else still live there? That's no. I just checking. Do you know if Ken Ford still lives there? Yes. All right. No, just checking. If you do, if you happen to know him, please talk to me when we're done. Number one. Number two. We got T-shirts for sale. Nerds T-shirts or tank tops if you go that way. But just over here on the side of the stage. You want a shirt? Come over. Pick it up. Fantastic stuff. There was somebody dancing wearing one of them before, and now she's gone. So anyway, where was I?
Open your eyes, look up to the skies and see. I'm just a poor boy, I need no sympathy, cause I'm easy come, easy go, little high, little low.
Baby, can't do this to me, baby.
nothing really matters.
Always remembering. National Science Foundation funded researchers at Penn State University have discovered that people have trouble remembering even very simple pieces of information when they don't expect to have to remember them. The team tested the memories of 100 undergraduate students. Each group was shown trials containing one letter and three numbers arranged in a square, and were told that they would need to report in which corner the letter
or number appeared.
The participants easily passed this portion of the test. But when the students were asked a surprise question, which letter appeared on the previous screen, only 25% of them identified the correct letter, the same rate one would get by randomly guessing. The team was surprised to find that the letter was not stored in memory, even though the task required the student to locate the letter. Brad Weibel and his team call this phenomenon attribute amnesia. It occurs when a person uses a piece of information to perform a task, but is then unable to report specifically what that information was, as little as 1 second later. The phenomenon was replicated several times using different forms of information, such as numbers and even simple colors. The team found that the people's expectations play an important role in determining what they remember, even for information they are specifically using to perform a task. Weibel says this selective memory storage might be a useful adaptation because it prevents the brain from remembering information that is probably unimportant.
So this work potentially has implications for our understanding of how we interpret people's memory in situations where they see things without necessarily having an expectation that that information will be important. So this might happen in a case of eyewitness testimony where someone sees an event happen. We immediately ask the questions as soon as it's over, and we assume that in cases like that, that presumably their information from their own memory systems is relatively reliable. But what we found is that even in those cases where you question someone just a few seconds or minutes after something has happened, they may have already forgotten or even failed to remember important details about the event that they just witnessed.
New experiments are underway to determine if older adults are as good at not remembering as younger ones. If their hypothesis is correct, the older adults may actually show less amnesia than the younger students. Talking to babies in the first year of life is important, but new research shows that actually naming things in their world can help them make connections between what they see and hear. National Science Foundation-funded University of Massachusetts Amherst researcher Lisa Scott began her study years ago with a group of 6 to 9 month old infants. She gave the parents books to read to them. The books had photos of either different monkey faces or different kinds of strollers. One group of parents used unique names to label images, such as Boris, and the other group was given the same label, monkey or stroller, for all the images. The team found that unique labels increased babies' ability to tell the difference between the images. Today, the same group of 4 to 5 year old children was tested again. They found that only the children who were given unique labels were faster to match human faces and exhibited more adult-like brain activity. The team says that infants learn labels for both people and objects at a very early age. Talking to infants frequently and describing the environment helps them learn more about what they see and hear. This work suggests that learning in infancy between 6 to 9 months lays a foundation for later childhood learning. Coral reefs are not only beautiful, but support an estimated 25% of all marine species, including more than 4,000 species of fish that rely on reefs for their very survival. These reefs also provide critical barriers to shoreline erosion, sustain fisheries, and feed hundreds of millions of people worldwide. But they are in peril. The National Science Foundation-funded research team at Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution has discovered that while the lowering of the ocean's pH level is making it harder for corals to grow their skeletons, it is also making it easier for bio-eroding organisms such as mollusks, worms, and sponges to tear them down. In a Pacific Basin-wide study of 11 coral reef ecosystems, the team used 3D CAT scans of coral skeletal cores to calculate precisely how much skeleton the bioeroders had removed. The new study shows that elevated nutrient concentrations provide a dramatic boost for bioeroders, and when combined with lower pH conditions, erosion rates increased tenfold. The team says that humans can help slow this reef decline by limiting nutrient pollution of the coastal oceans by activities that increase runoff from land, sewer, and septic tank discharge, and excess use of fertilizer. If you think your computer is safe at the coffee house, think again. A new class of hackers has found a way to steal your personal data by analyzing the low-power electronic signals your laptop and smartphone emit, even when they're not connected to the internet. A National Science Foundation-funded team of researchers at Georgia Institute of Technology discovered that side channel emissions can be measured several feet away from an operating computer using a variety of spying methods. Some can be picked up by a simple AM/FM radio, and all without the user's knowledge.
Well, this is definitely different from how hackers normally get your information, because here what we're talking about is we're dealing with so-called side channels, which means it's that the computer is transmitting information even though it's not meant to transmit it.
Each computer operation has a different potential for leaking information and draws different amounts of current depending on the operation. The team says while it's not possible to eliminate all side channel signals, the trick is to make those signals so weak that potential hackers would have to be extremely close and use a much larger antenna that might arouse suspicion. In an effort to counter the threat, the researchers have developed a metric for measuring the strength of leaks. The team is currently working to determine where the leaks originate and which processes are most susceptible.
We want to analyze the signals, understand where they're coming from, how strong they impact the computation, and try to find the measures that would help both software and hardware engineers solve this problem.
For more information about these stories, visit us at nsf.gov. This is NSF Science Now. I'm Dina Headley.
Made her college years possible, opening that education savings account when she was little, spearheading campus tours, and deciphering financial aid. If you can ace planning for college, you can do it for retirement. Get on track with tips at aceyourretirement.org.
Opioid dependence can happen after just 5 days. Know the truth, spread the truth.